shine like sunshine, like springtime, like something's in the water and I'm taking a deep dive. I'm feeling so weightless, like I'm gonna make it, and nothing in the universe can take this. I can see it clearly now, nothing gonna bring me down.
Welcome to the National University of Singapore Yong Lu Lim School of Medicine Healthy Longevity Webinar. Thanks for joining us again. We're very lucky tonight to have Professor Vadim Gladyshev, who will be talking to us in a few minutes, and I'll introduce him in a second. If you've noticed, I'm actually wearing glasses tonight as well. This is a very rare occasion for me, but actually people tell me I look younger in glasses, so let me know if you agree with that. And I want to remind you also to use the Q&A function to send questions, and Belinda will try to get to those questions later in the show. Before we get to Vadim, though, I want to start with Matthias Robert, who's a research assistant at the Healthy Longevity Translational Research Program, to be telling us about the impact of therapy-induced senescent secretomes.
Thank you for the kind introduction. As mentioned, my name is Matt. And today, I will be sharing with you about the impact of therapy-induced senescent secretome as part of our work here at CHL. So it is already known that cancer treatment itself could mediate cellular senescence. And this is termed as therapy-induced senescence, or TIS. When cells become senescent, they secrete a bioactive component called senescence-associated secretory phenotype, or the SAPs. SAPs are pro-inflammatory and could mediate fatigue, cardiac morbidity, as well as physical decline, all of which are often observed in cancer patients as well as cancer survivors. This is also observed with people with age-related morbidity. So while soluble factors of SAPs, such as cytokines and chemokines, have been extensively studied, not much focus has been placed on the insoluble factors of SAPs, specifically small extracellular vesicles, or SEVs. So in this work, we aim to understand the potential effects of SEVs in both normal and cancerous contexts. To that end, the work in the lab, we have developed a TIS model of MB231 breast cancer cells by treating with anti-mitotic drug paclitaxel, which are clinically used for chemotherapy. And we found that TIS could be induced by 72 hours of paclitaxel treatment indicated with high SA beta gal activity here. We also use other senescence markers such as increased P53 activity, increased P21 activity, and degradation of lamin B1, which could be seen at 72 hours of treatment up until day 6 post-treatment. After confirming senescence, we collected CM from TIS and check for and quantify presence of human cytokines. Here, we could see TIS-CM is enriched in several pro-inflammatory cytokines, such as IL-1A, IL-1B, IL-6, and IL-4. Which all have been implicated in enhancing tumorigenic behavior, such as invasion. In a simple experiment using wound healing assay, where we create an identical wound in a cell monolayer, we could see that TICM could facilitate or enhanced wound closure rate, indicating that TISM increases migratory capacity of MB2G1 cells. On the other hand, to characterize EVs from TISM, we could isolate SEVs by subjecting CM into a sequential ultracentrifugation and column-based method. Here, isolated SEVs observed through scanning electron microscope are rounded and cup-shaped. We also found through nanoparticle tracking analysis that TIS cells indeed secrete more SEVs compared to control. Further works are still ongoing to properly characterize the effects of TIS SEVs in both normal and cancerous contexts. But we hope that the findings of this study would add value into the growing body of knowledge about SAS. I'd like to thank the members of my lab and our collaborators that have helped for this project. If you are interested more about this work in detail, please check out this previous episode of the webinar titled More to the Senescent Stress Secretome Than Meets the Eye. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. And I'm very lucky tonight to introduce Vadim Gladyshev. I've known him for many years now. He's a professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School, director of the Center for Redox Medicine at Brigham and Women's Hospital, and an associate member of the Broad Institute. He's also a recipient of the NIH Pioneer Transformative and Eureka Awards. That's like the trifecta of funding in NIH. He's gotten all of them, and a member of the National Academy of Sciences. His research has focused for a long time on redox biology, but more recently, especially focusing on aging, rejuvenation, and lifespan control using experimental and computational approaches. So we're very excited what you have to say to us tonight, Vadim. The title is Quantifying Aging, Rejuvenation, and Longevity. Take it away.
Thank you, Brian. So it's really an honor to be here and participate in your amazing show. So I will tell a little bit today about quantifying aging, rejuvenation, and longevity. And if we discuss like any topic in this area, I think we need to ask a first question, which is what is aging? So this is because various members of our scientific community view aging in a completely different way. So some people think of this process as, for example, increased mortality rate, and some follow HLA changes or decreased fitness or functional decline and so on. You know, some people like me think of damage accumulation. And depending on that, we refer to aging. When we say aging, we refer to completely different processes. So when we design our research programs, we have to keep in mind some kind of models of what exactly we study. And this is something actually often is kind of missing in the fundamental background is missing in the presentations. So I'd like to highlight that. And so just because it's a short presentation, there's no time to actually describe the model we have. I will just show it in a very kind of brief way. So basically what we think when we kind of refer to aging, we think of damage. It's kind of molecular damage that accumulates as a result of life. So we have all kinds of processes in the cell and they do whatever they do. Functions, gene function, organ function, so on, so systemic functions. As a result, they produce negative consequences. And these negative consequences eventually result in functional decline, disease, and mortality. So in that sense, to me, increased chance of dying is not aging. And even chance of disease or even functional decline is not aging. It's one of the manifestations of aging. And it becomes really difficult because how exactly can we target this process? That's a big question. So to address this, we developed a research program in the lab where we kind of study this at the level of longevity, aging, and rejuvenation. And I will tell you a little bit what this means. So at the level of longevity, we study the potential to live long. So for example, we analyze longevity across cell types. Some cells, they live short, like cells in the blood, for example, or some cells are long-lived, like cardiomyocytes or neurons. They can live a whole life. We also study longevity across mammals. Some mammals are short-lived, like shrews. They may live only 2 years. Whales can live more than 200 years. So there's a huge diversity in lifespan, even though all these animals have the same ancestor. So nature somehow is able to adjust lifespan 100-fold or more. Also longevity across interventions, because now we already know many interventions that can extend lifespan. We can ask a question, what is common among them? Is there like a one way, like a central kind of pathway or path to increase lifespan, or kind of diverse directions? So this analysis results in what we call signatures of longevity, which are basically omics patterns, which indicate the potential of the system to live long. This is not age that changes. So they may not change with age, but they kind of control how long an organism or cell or the system lives. At the same time, we study this at the level of aging. And aging is age that changes here. And these changes need to be quantified. So we develop what is known as epigenetic clocks, transcriptomic clocks, other kind of omics-based biomarkers, as well as causal biomarkers. This leads to actionable biomarkers of aging, which we can use to quantify this process. And the third component is rejuvenation. And in a simple way, it can be viewed as an opposite to aging, but it's not exactly the opposite to aging, because I don't think we can exactly reverse in the same kind of direction, in the same way. Because, for example, like, you know, random mutations happen. We cannot eliminate those random mutations. But yet, we could make an organism or a system a little bit younger. And for this, we need to develop separate rejuvenation signatures. So this allows us, you know, in all these three kind of components, allows us to target aging and rejuvenation and develop candidate interventions, for example, dietary, pharmacological, and generic. So I will highlight how we do this. So for example, in this study, we just published about a month ago, we analyzed gene expression signatures of longevity across 41 species of mammals. So these are shown here on the left, and we profiled them in three organs, primarily brain, liver, and kidney, but also to some degree in additional organs. And some representative genes are shown here, like three representative genes in three organs. You can see they consistently change with age. So for example, if one gene increases gene expression in the brain, typically it also increases in the liver and in the kidney, and so on. And altogether, we have maybe 500 to 1,000 such genes across each tissue. It allows us to develop these longevity signatures and use them in various ways. So another example is the relationship among longevity interventions. In this study published already 4 years ago, we analyzed what is already known in mouse. This has about 15 different ways known to extend lifespan. We profile them through omics approaches. And what is shown is a Spearman correlation matrix. And kind of red in a scale here indicates kind of clustering of different interventions. So for example, it's clear that many interventions modify mouse in similar ways, whether we, for example, do methionine restriction or calorie restriction or FGF21 overexpression, growth hormone receptor knockout, various generic models. They kind of do the same thing at the molecular level. But then there are other ways to extend lifespan. For example, c-MYC deficiency. You see, it kind of stands on its own. It's not related to any of these interventions, yet it also allows lifespan extension. Or rapamycin also kind of stands on its own. Protenzyme. So apparently, there are many ways to extend lifespan. This also provides a realization, which is something we consistently see across different models. It's never one way. It's always there are many different ways to modify longevity. So now we are able to relate all these signatures of longevity and signatures of aging to one another. And this is really a very interesting, I think, perspective, provides a very interesting perspective. So for example, here on this slide, we look at the signatures of longevity in the brain, like across mammals, in the kidney across mammals, in the liver, and so on. And you can see that they cluster to one another. So something that changes in the brain that leads to longevity often also changes in the liver, in the kidney. So in this cluster, we look at gene expression changes during aging. Aging, for example, in the muscle across mammals, in the brain across mammals, across tissues in humans, global across mammals and across tissues, across mouse tissues, across liver in mammals, and so on. And so they are also clustered to one another. So also there are common age-related changes. And the third component is signatures of longevity interventions. For example, signature of growth hormone deficiency, like interventions like across different, it's a common signature, scalar restriction and so on, rapamycin. And we also see that they cluster generally to one another. But how all these three kind of blocks of signatures are related to each other. So what we see is that first, species longevity, you know, positively correlates with aging. So in a way, this means that at the level of gene expression changes during aging, long-lived mammals are older, not younger. So they seem to be older, which is a little bit of a paradox. It can be explained by the fact that potentially, it's still a hypothesis, that during aging, we not only accumulate damage, but also organism responds to this damage by activating protective adaptive systems. And the similar systems are used by species for lifespan extension, basically. So that's why there is a correlation. Another realization is that species longevity does not correlate with longevity across interventions. These are completely different mechanisms. So whatever we study in the lab through simple interventions, like gene manipulation or dietary or pharmacological, is not the same as how species extend lifespan. So this probably means that longevity across species, the potential of this, what nature does, is basically untapped. This is really, I think, important to study longevity across species. Now, when we relate all of this to each other, across species interventions, across aging, and try to link them to different pathways, what are the kind of systems and pathways emerge? So what we observe is, for example, mitochondrial translation, ribosome, oxidative phosphorylation, DNA repair, and so on. So these are the kind of the basic major processes that are related to aging, to maximum lifespan, and to interventions in positive and negative way. Of course, this is just the beginning of this road. We need to study this more, but I think it just provides a very fresh and new perspective on the nature of lifespan control. Now, we could use these interventions to identify new signatures, to identify new interventions. So for example, we could screen public data and identify kind of conditions which are related to longevity signatures. Things like hypoxia, you see it's related to many longevity signatures. It's a good candidate for lifespan extension, or keep one knockout and so on. And if you want to shorten lifespan, we also can inject interleukin-6. That signature corresponds to shorter lifespan. And we also have done a chemical screen where we screened many thousands of compounds with these signatures, identified candidate longevity interventions. We just reported in a paper about a month ago that actually this previously predicted compound does extend lifespan. We're currently testing some of these compounds and actually many other compounds. And of course, many other interventions, which basically this kind of approach allows unbiased identification of longevity interventions, at least to enrich them. Now I'd like to switch to biomarkers of aging, which is something which is almost a revolution in the field. This was started by Steve Horvath, who developed the first human epigenetic clock. And we kind of followed on his steps and developed the mouse epigenetic clock. I show as an example, our first clock published already 6 years ago. And of course, there are many other, but it's just good for illustration purposes. So here we have a clock that quantifies correspondence between the actual age of the mouse and predicted age of the mouse, 16 age groups. And you can see there is very good correspondence. And then these 4 points correspond to calorie restriction. The mice are subjected to calorie restriction. And you can see that at any of these 4 points, based on the clocks, they are younger than their chronological age. So in this case, we could test the effect of calorie restriction on biological age without the need to follow them until they die. We could do it much, much quickly. For example, at 10 months of age, we already can see differences. This is another example, chronologically identical mice cross hormone receptor knockout and control, but you can see that the knockout mice are biologically younger. And in this case, we apply our clocks to cell reprogramming when we convert fibroblasts to induced pluripotent stem cells, and you can see that the age of these cells goes to zero, which it should be because they correspond to embryonic state. The clocks work also at that level. So we also applied, we also developed a single cell clock. This is something that was developed by Alex Trapp, a former lab member, and the program is called SCH, which stands for single cell aging clock, epigenetic clock. And when we applied this clock to tissues, we observed that many cells indeed age according to their chronological age, but some cells, they age slower. We observed this in many stem cells, for example, like muscle stem cells. And also some cells age more rapidly than a typical cell. We think some of these cells are senescent cells, but maybe some other cells. But the point is that when we look at tissue, we observe actually quite substantial heterogeneity in the aging rates. So when we analyze tissue at the bulk level, actually kind of represents different aging trajectories for different cells. Another paper that we published earlier this year, this was done by Jesse Poganik and other colleagues in the lab. It's also a large study with many collaborators, where we study basically how biological age changes, how rapidly it can change. And what Jesse found is that biological age does not just go steadily with age, does not steadily increase, it actually fluctuates. So under severe stress, it can rapidly increase here. And then once the stress is relieved, it goes back to almost normal. Well, it depends on the system. And we kind of expose this pattern through four different models. That's a major surgery, severe COVID-19, also pregnancy. Pregnancy means here is like women in the third trimester seem to be a little bit older than the chronological age, but postpartum, the age goes down to normal. So, and also similarly in other models. And also in the case of parabiosis, when we connect young and old mice, then young mice rapidly become older when they have a joint circulatory system with the old mice. But once we separate them, young mice, they are able to deal with the damage that kind of transferred from the old mice, and their age can be normalized, biological age can be normalized. And I think this is also an important recent realization, that potentially could be targeted in clinical settings. In terms of parabiosis, there's another paper, actually it was published last week. This was done by Bohan Zeng. He's currently a postdoctoral fellow in the lab, and it's a collaboration with the lab of Jim White at Duke University. So in this case, we connect young and old mice for 3 months. So they have a joint circulatory system for 3 months. And after 3 months, we separate them and follow for another 2 months, and then later in life. And what we find is that these mice are longer lived. So when we connect the mice, so they become younger, 2 months later, when after the separation, the old mice are still younger than controls, and also they are longer lived. Their lifespan is extended. So I think parabiosis represents perhaps one of the most robust ways to rejuvenate organisms currently. It's better than, at least I haven't seen a better one, better way as of now. And these are some of the examples here, so application of the epigenetic blocks. I think this is based on the reduced representation of bisulfite sequencing, but also we've done this through like the array, mammalian array with Steve Horvath and also transcriptomic locks and so on. Basically, we find that, for example, in the liver, after 3 months of attachment, the old mice are younger than controls, and after detachment, they still remain younger. So another kind of example of rejuvenation is something that we developed in the last couple of years. And these are some of the papers that we published on this topic. And this is rejuvenation during embryogenesis. What we found is that after conception, when the zygote is formed, the biological age of the zygote is quite low, but it's not zero. It's just slightly above zero. And then during early embryonic development, initially it doesn't change much, but then after implantation, it goes down to the minimal state. We call it ground zero. And we think that aging begins at that point. It's approximately at the stage of gastrulation in mammals. Mm-hmm. And from this point, this is the time when the soma is born and the germline is born. Then we observe, increased biological age based on the clocks. So we published this conceptual paper, and then in this paper we described this in the case of mouse embryos. In this paper, at the level of single cells, and also there's a paper. It's not yet published, actually. It should be published very soon, where we analyze this in the human kind of cell culture model. And also there's another paper in the frogs. So they're all self-consistent, but of course it's just been done only in our lab, because it would be good to kind of extend it and validate by other labs. So I'll just show you one example of that. Here we apply our single cell clock, this SCH clock developed by Alex Trapp. And we observe that this is the epiblast embryonic day 4.5 in mice, 5.5, 6.5, 7.5. You can see each point is one cell where we predict the biological age, and the biological age decreases. The rejuvenation actually is observed in all three germ layers, ectoderm, mesoderm, endoderm, in the primitive streak, but interestingly, not in the extraembryonic tissues. So it seems like extraembryonic tissues, for example, the cells that become, later placenta, they do not seem to be rejuvenated fully, at least. So another recent development in the lab is the work of Alex Shkovsky, who developed a transcriptomic clock. And currently, we actually apply both epigenetic and transcriptomic clocks, which are, of course, different omics modalities, to assess biological age. And very often, we observe that they correspond to one another. This clock is actually to develop it, we had to analyze many, many samples, over 3,000 samples. And this includes many samples from the ITP program, where we adjusted for lifespan. We basically sequenced all of the interventions that are known to extend lifespan to develop this clock. And the best clock currently in the mouse, it's a kind of mouse red clock in the some of the tissues shown here, plus multi-tissue clock, and we have also a human clock. And when we apply this clock to like embryonic development, I told you about epigenetic clocks, we also observe the same. We also observe that the level of at the age of the zygote is slightly above zero, and the biological age decreases based on the transcriptomic clock approximately to the castration stage, and then it increases. Now I'd like to discuss a little bit of a challenges in the field. I told you that these biomarkers almost represent a revolution, but yet there is a lot of skepticism in the field and a lot of challenges, I would say. And I would like to represent one challenge. And here is the Midjourney image of the same man in the younger state and older state. You can see that this man has his hair, gray. There's a loss of hair as well. But these are changes that they are not causal to aging. They just kind of happen during aging. We also observe other changes. For example, there's a wearing glasses, so wearing hearing aid. We can extend it to the, for example, visit to doctors or, walking cane or wheelchair and so on. These are age-related changes. And we could build a clock based on these changes and accurately predict the age of the person. And then we fire all doctors. There will be no glasses, no hearing aid. No, nobody goes to doctor's office. And based on this clock, everybody is going to be young, which is not the case, right? So at the molecular level, it should be the same. So basically, when we build clocks, we not only incorporate aging per se, but we also incorporate changes which represent adaptations, protective changes, changes which represent organismal response to aging. Because they are also age-related changes, they end up in the clocks. And we need to separate these different modalities in age-related changes in order to quantify aging per se. Yeah. In fact, when we observe age-related changes, they're almost uninterpretable. Very often at conferences, we hear, we find this protein changes with age. That means it's important. I would say it's not. It tells us nothing whether this protein is important. Maybe this age-related change, it represents damage. Maybe it's a protection against damage. Maybe it's a neutral change, and so on. So to address that, Alex Yin, who is a graduate student in the lab, developed the first causal biomarkers of aging, first causal epigenetic clock. So he combined a large genetic screen Mendelian randomization with age related changes to identify CpG sites, which not only change with age, but also represent causal patterns. So when he combines this, he can develop a clock, aging clock. When he separates them and only uses damaging sites, the clock also can be built. If he only uses protective sites, this is, could be adaptage, also the clock is built, almost similar to the damaging clock. But they represent completely different perspectives. And this this becomes evident when we apply them in the context of rejuvenation. Here we reprogram fibroblasts to iPS cells, and we find that damage-based clock shows rejuvenation, but adapt age does not. So these adaptive protective changes, this is the so-called glasses, hearing aid, walking cane, wheelchairs, you know, they are not aging, they are protective aging, if protective changes, and if we eliminate them, it doesn't mean that the aging is reversed. So this provides just kind of another challenge. In fact, I would, in this slide, you can see many challenges that remain that need to be addressed. And I just explained to you this challenge associated with aging versus adaptation, but many other change, you know, challenges like aging versus development. You know, there's stochastic versus regulatory processes. So how do we separate them and what is the dominant? It seems like both are present currently. Aging versus rejuvenation, that's another kind of a key feature because we cannot just go directly in the same direction. We cannot reverse the aging process. You could rejuvenate an organism, but not really go by the same road back. Also the cost, it's expensive. We are developing kind of more reliable, you know, less expensive approaches currently. We work on many of these challenges, of course, not only us, not only our lab, but you know, many other labs in the field, which is like, it's a really exciting time, but also we have to be honest and state openly that we don't know exactly what the biomarkers measure. And we need to understand that and develop the best biomarkers available that could be used in interventions and clinical trials. So as a result, although we have a biomarker revolution and we have the ability to quantify various aspects of aging, test longevity interventions, there are opportunities for many advances. Yet challenges remain, many questions remain, and there is a skepticism also in the field which needs to be addressed. So another way to address that is, we try to address this, to develop, to organize a consortium. We call it Biomarkers of Aging Consortium. And this is the initial scientific committee. It's myself, Mike Snyder, Vittorio Sebastiano, your own Andre Meyer and Eric Verdin from Bach. This is a executive committee, Madi, who was actually instrumental in organizing the whole thing, Jesse, Allison, and Dane. And so we started early this year, organized this group of about 25 different labs, leading labs in the space of aging biomarkers. And we already have a first manuscript, just got accepted in Cell. Of course, there's a continuation of the process. We need to address questions like, what is biomarker of aging? What is biological age? What is aging, actually? And how do we apply? What is the best biomarker? How can we validate even? How to develop guidelines for validation? These are key questions that need to be addressed. We also will have an inaugural symposium. It will happen December 4th at the Buck Institute. This is the website for the symposium. And if you'd like to learn more about the consortium, also this is the website. Finally, I just wanted to give one example of how we address this in the lab. This is the work of Albert Ying, who developed a tool called ClockBase. Basically, he analyzed the entire GO database with major, like most, the best currently epigenetic clocks. So if you're interested, you can go to this website and, you know, if somebody has done some work at the level of DNA methylation, you would be able to basically to see the biological age of these samples. Also this site provides visualization tools that allows you to build plots for your publications. So we hope that this would accelerate research in the field. We really made it available even prior to publication. We haven't even submitted the paper yet for publication, only placed it in bioarchive, but we'd like to promote the use of the clocks in this way. That's it. So this is my current lab. And I told you the work of Jesse, Alex, Bohan, Madi, and Albert primarily, and a little bit of other people, but also previous lab members contributed, particularly Alex Trapp and Chaba Kiripeshi. And these are our collaborators on this project, on various aspects of these projects. This is the lab, which picture was taken like a half a year ago in our funding. And I would like to thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks, Vadim. That's great. A lot to talk about. So let's jump right into it. One question, you said you view aging as molecular damage. Do you have a lot of people have debated DNA damage, protein damage, proteostasis. People don't talk about lipids. There's a lot of damage there. Do you think that damage is specified in any way, or it's just a general accumulation of different kinds of damage?
So in our lab, we do not particularly like the word damage. We use the word deleterium, because what this is not just molecular damage. It's the negative consequence of being alive. So when we have our genes, when the genes function, when the systems function, they also unavoidably produce negative consequences. Of course, damage as well, for example, byproducts of metabolism, mutations, epimutations, altered gene expression level, hormone levels, and so on. So this is unavoidable because chemistry is imperfect. You know, we have biology, but, you know, it's built on chemistry and the chemical processes are imperfect. So whatever, the enzyme can be very good, right? And its exercise could be really good, but it's not 100% efficient. So there's always non-zero likelihood of producing something else. And that something else comes from every single process. It's never just DNA damage or epigenetic damage or, you know, mitochondria. And actually, I don't like this kind of idea of gene-centric analysis in aging, because this, in a way, this is misleading. Because once we say, you know, mitochondria is a key, like in aging, or like, you know, mitochondria drives aging, that's it, we lost the essence of aging. Because the essence is systemic. It's a systems process. And of course, it's very challenging to study it. We've been trained as reductionists. We'd like to identify a small component, whether it's a DNA damage, mitochondria, or telomere shortening, whatever, and try to explain aging, but it just doesn't work this way.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think that may be one of the reasons that if you look at the interventions that extend lifespan, they're not targeted to a specific kind of damage or a specific problem. They're presumably something that maintains the function of the system longer, or that maintains homeostasis longer. I don't know how you think about that, but I think there's been a lot of efforts to try to repair one process. And so far, I think it's been disappointing, the effects of lifespans of those kinds of approaches.
Yes, what we find basically that known interventions, these are compounds and, well, could be lifestyle or genetic interventions as well, which kind of remodel the organism. It's like typically metabolic remodeling. Let's say you shift from like glycolysis to oxidative phosphorylation or modified in some other way, so that the system becomes somewhat different and it accumulates different types of damages, somewhat different types of damage. And in sometimes it just becomes longer lived. This is, in essence, how it works. It's never one particular process. That's why, for example, all these antioxidant genes, they failed, because the idea was only to target oxidative damage, which is only a small subset. So, and we need to deal with the entirety of damage, which is very difficult. And that's why the clocks, for the first time, provide an opportunity to address it, because they are, you know, kind of first generation systemic biomarkers. Even though imperfect, there are still many challenges, but at least partially systemic, and allows us to quantify the aging process.
I think a lot of people were surprised when the data started coming out that these clocks are not just linear. You know, if you talk to some people, they'll say the fact that they move around and oscillate based on your current biologic state is a sign that they're not measuring aging, because aging must be an accumulation of problems. So how do you interpret this sort of flexibility in biologic age that comes with stress or with lifestyle changes, etc.?
My answer is that we need to ask exactly the same question I posed at the beginning. What is aging? When they say it's not aging, I need to ask them, how do they view aging? What is aging in their way? If it's damage, then under severe stress, there's more damage. For example, consider pregnancy, right? So there's a huge metabolic demand for the kind of during fetal development, a demand on the woman's body. So it accumulates more damage. And we observe this also at the level of, for example, gestation diabetes, other like chance of getting a heart attack, other kind of challenges which kind of go away later. Yeah. So to me, the women become literally older at that point. So, but other people would say, well, it's not damage. It's just, it's maybe inflammation or something else. But it just means they don't think about the nature of aging, which is, I think, essential in any of the studies.
You think it's possible to measure hormesis in these clocks? In other words, you could have a little bit of hormesis being the idea that some kind of stress triggers the system to react, and it actually prolongs lifespan of the organism for the audience. So I'm curious if you could see that in a clock. In other words, you impose some sort of stress, maybe the organism gets biologically older in the short term, but then it returns to a point that was less than the starting point. Do you think that's possible?
It is possible, yeah. This would represent mild stress. But of course, what I presented is severe stress. Mm-hmm. It's not the same. So, the examples that we observe, for example, if somebody like breaks a hip, and it's just kind of emergency surgery. But even in the case when the hip is broken and this kind of surgery is pre-planned, then we don't see that. So it's kind of organism adapts in advance. So, but under severe stress, we observe these kind of reversible changes. Mild stress actually often is beneficial. So biological age presumably can even be decreased. And we're also trying to understand that in the lab currently. So although there are not yet good data, so we'll see.
Well, that brings us a little bit to this idea of adaptive changes, and I was really curious that the adaptive changes, if I understood you correctly, are not reversed, through rejuvenation, whereas damage-related, like an adaptive clock is not reversed, whereas a damage-related clock is reversed. If the source of adaptation or the events that happen during aging and that source goes away, why is the adaptive clock not changed back, if I'm understanding correctly?
No, adaptive, they may or may not change. What I'm trying to say is that these are not causal changes. So if we target changes represented by adaptive changes, right? So this is the biomarker. So then, it's uninterpretable changes. So whether the clock would indicate whether the organism is young or not, it's very hard to interpret, yeah?
I was thinking of adaptive responses to aging-related changes, and that's different than what you're trying to say. So, yeah, that's interesting. Let me add a couple questions. You had the CMAP, which predicts drugs, and you're doing the omic-related analysis based on species intervention and rate of aging. And I think that, when you tried to predict those drugs that would have an effect, I didn't catch which of those clocks, which of those omics data sets that you're using. And if you're using all three of them differently, do they predict different drugs or similar drugs?
Well, our major kind of tool is longevity signatures. So basically, just discussed earlier in my talk, these longevity signatures across species and across interventions, right? So we screen initially CMAP. We identify this is basically a way to kind of reduce the number of potential candidates. So let's say from 4,000 to 200 allows us to reduce. And then what we've done, we repeated the screen in primary cells because CMAP is primarily cancer cells. So we actually used human hepatocytes and then tested about 200 interventions in the same settings and kind of robotic way at the Broad Institute, and redone RNA-seq also just to make sure that we validate at the level of signatures. And then we chose the best compounds and actually made diets and gave these diets to mice for 1 month and redone RNA-seq as well. So this is a way just for us to reduce the number and identify really good candidates for lifespan extension. And only then we test them in mice for lifespan. Yep. So, and this is how it's done. But at the same time, of course, when we treat mice with these interventions, we also apply aging clocks. Particularly in this particular case, transcriptomic clock is very useful. So it's not the same compounds that are predicted by different tools. So the way we do it is that sometimes we look for interventions that the best kind of best candidates for each tool. Sometimes we integrate all of the tools. I mean, it's an ongoing process. But what I can tell you is just the success rate is very high. So we observe like 50% currently success rate at the level of actually testing for lifespan. It's much higher success rate than, for example, ITP program.
I was also curious of the fact that the interventions are very different signatures than the longevity difference across species. It made me wonder that if they're now starting to be interventions that affect longevity in a mouse that were derived from differences in species. For instance, hyaluronan comes to mind with Vera Gorbanova's work. It would be interesting to test those interventions and see if they fall into more of the species relationship than the other interventions do.
Yeah, we actually regularly testing. In fact, in the paper, Vera's paper that you mentioned, we are also co-authors and contribute the type of analysis. But we do this regularly, and so far, it's very hard to recapitulate kind of species longevity. Of course, there are some extreme cases of adaptations that make more developed, or whales, bats, and so on. But in general, the interventions existing interventions do not recapitulate species longevity, presumably because species longevity is based on many genes and genes. It's just never just one single process. It's very difficult to recapitulate this in the animal system, but at least it can be tried, and the potential for radical kind of lifespan extension would be a completely different level.
From a naive standpoint, it seems like these different long-lived species have identified different pathways to get to long lifespan. Would you agree with that, or are there commonalities we're missing?
So what we observe is that different long-lived species, we study many exceptionally long-lived species, they seem to develop different ways to lifespan extension. What we observe in the Nagmoor rat is not the same, for example, in the whale or in the bat. But at the same time, there are also common changes. And what I discussed today is mostly common changes. Like, for example, when we analyze things across like 40 species of mammals, we observe this longevity of the species at the species level, longevity signatures. They represent common changes, kind of mostly metabolic, kind of systemic remodeling kind of changes. But they seem to be different again from the interventions.
Interesting. One last question, and then I'll go to the audience. I was fascinated by the idea that during early development, the cells get younger, and then later as development progression, aging starts. And you suggested aging is somewhere around gastrulation in early development. And I wondered how that relationship compares to the change in potency of cells during development, because you have embryonic cells which are capable of forming anything, and they slowly lose their multipotency during development. Is there a link between those changes and the start of aging?
Yeah, we don't fully understand it yet, because there are many kind of really key events that happen during exactly this process, or kind of similar timing. The birth of the soma, birth of the germline, as you said, pluripotency, kind of key elements in differentiation. So all of these changes, there's another one called phylotypic state, when like mammals, they seem to be different at the level of the zygote, but then converge to the same morphological state, but later diverge again. So we're trying to understand the relationship between all of these events. But this really, I think, provides very, very interesting perspectives, not only on the beginning of aging, but also on the beginning of life. So also on the nature of differentiation. For example, like at the level of a conception, we have extremely differentiated cells like sperm and oocyte, and then they fuse, and suddenly we call this cell zygote least differentiated, which makes no sense to me. So in that sense, we need to understand when does life begin, life of an organism begin? Does it begin at the level of conception, or it begins a little bit later? So when for example, we form individuality, right? When we, at the early stage, we could, for example, take blastocyst from one species, fuse blastocyst in another species, form chimera even. So what does it say about the individuality of life? All of these big questions can be addressed, but the important thing is that they all came from the utilizing epigenetic clocks, aging clocks. It's really amazing kind of advances that may happen. And this is one, some of the examples. This is biomarkers of aging.
That's great. I'm going to bring Belinda in and also ask Joe if he can add about 4 or 5 minutes to the clock, because I went too long. And so I'm going to steal a little bit more of your time, Vadim, if that's okay.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Professor Gladyshev, for that really insightful presentation. We have a lot of really exciting questions from the audience as well. So without further ado, let's dig in. During your presentation, you talked about parabiosis, so where you have the young mouse and the older mouse. And then we can see that through that parabiosis, it causes rejuvenation. The audience, David Wood, is wondering, what is the mechanism for that?
That's a very good question. We don't know. We don't know exactly what's the mechanism. We're trying to understand, because there are kind of different ideas. When animals develop a joint circulatory system, they, of course, they exchange cells in the blood, but they also exchange plasma, and old animals also have access to the younger organs. So they could utilize the young kidney and young liver to help them. So and which of this kind of is dominant is unclear. So to me also, I'm a little bit skeptical of approaches when, for example, like a blood injection is used, because blood, when we inject, I think it cannot really fully recapitulate. It's kind of very transient. So I'm a little bit surprised that there are kind of effects on aging. We find basically that it's very difficult to rejuvenate organisms. So almost like we try many different approaches, the biological age kind of doesn't want to decrease. And the parabiosis is kind of the most robust so far that we observe. Provides a very, very significant kind of decrease. It would be nice to recapitulate it in a more simple way. Maybe it's a blood or access to organs or whatever, the plasma, but we don't know yet.
Great answer. Okay. Actually, I'm also quite curious. Do you think that could be seen across different species as well?
The effect of parabiosis?
Yeah.
Presumably. I mean, this would be a... I don't see why it shouldn't. I mean, it's not really applicable, unfortunately, to human situation, but it potentially can. Or what do you mean is that would you develop circulatory system between different species, or like it's kind of intraspecific kind of parabiosis, like rat to rat or rat to mouse? What do you mean?
True. Okay. So your lab and your team, so you guys have created a lot of clots for different species as well, right? So one of our members is wondering, what is the biggest challenge or criticism for aging clots and how to address them?
Yeah, we described several clots. Last year, we published a paper on the neck nodule red clot, for example, which is I didn't include it in this presentation, but also provides interesting kind of perspective, because neck mole rats, they not show increased mortality with age, but the clock can be built and actually shows that they do age, kind of relates to what is aging in the neck mole rat. But I think it's primarily Steve Horvath who developed many clocks for various species, as well as this kind of multi-species. Really, his work is really amazing in that perspective. we contribute to that work, but it's primarily Steve's work. And so this is an extremely useful tool. But in terms of challenges, I try to highlight some of the challenges in my presentation. I guess the main challenge is, what do we quantify? Like, which aspects of aging do we want to quantify? Is it aspect that relates to, for example, mortality or to functional decline or damage accumulation? This would be different clocks. So, and then which clocks exactly would need to be used, like in the interventions, in the clinical trials? This is a completely open question. It's not a simple question to answer. And often we get questions like, okay, well, I'd like to do a clinical trial, which clock should I use? I say, we don't know. We need a consensus. We need to develop guidelines for that. That's exactly why we formed this consortium of biomarker of aging consortium.
The consortium is really the first step.
And it's not a question for one lab even. It's a question for the entire field.
Thank you so much. So during one of your slides, you showed us that biological age could be reversible due to severe stress. So one of our members is actually wondering, like, what about chronic stress as opposed to acute stress? What happens to the biological age?
Well, it's not our work, but there are many studies in the field that kind of compare chronic stress versus no stress. And there are many examples when the biological age is increased by chronic stress. So our study is different because we kind of show that it kind of fluctuates on a short time scales. But chronic stress, I think it's kind of more obvious. You know, you have stress, it, you know, produces damage, and the biological age becomes higher over time. So that's kind of reasonable, I think.
So for your work, when you show the kind of reverse effect, what is the possible explanation for that?
When we study aging, we think in terms of damage, deleterious changes, as I mentioned. So under severe stress, one way to interpret that, there's more damage accumulates, just organism is unable to deal with it. And once the stress is relieved, I think some of the damage can be cleared. And this kind of relieves the stress and also decreases biological age. This is just one way, but it's a model, right? We don't understand fully the process. And also we don't use the word rejuvenation in this case, because actually that's another question, like what exactly is rejuvenation? So is it just any age reversal or only reversal relative to the kind of normal aging? Under severe stress condition, we initially elevate biological aging and decrease, but we decrease to the kind of normal level. Is it rejuvenation or not? I don't know. We don't use that word in that particular study.
If I could jump in, you know, if you look in a severe stress environment like that, you're using a clock that was adapted from normal aging, I think, and then applying it to severe stress. So it presumably is not affecting all of the epigenetic sites the same. And so if you dug into the whole clock and looked at the whole compilation of sites, you might imagine that some are more affected than others. And that also raises the question of how to work from individual sites that contribute to clocks back to gene expression and ultimately to function. How have you thought about that?
Yeah, it needs to be addressed. But also, like, there are different models of severe stress. For example, when we use the model of parabiosis, basically any clocks, whatever clocks we use, actually they show the same effect. So, but then if we have a more kind of mild situation, like, for example, you know, COVID-19. I mean, it's not mild, but in terms of severe stress, it is mild. So then we only observe the effect in the kind of second generation clocks, like a Grimm age, Fino age, things like that. Whereas the original Horvath clock does not show an effect. So I think it also depends on the kind of severity of cases. You know, and then as a result, you know, different sets of CPGs are affected.
So one of our member from the Healthy Longevity Translational Research Program, Mitchell, as we know, some medications like metformin and R-couples, they have associations with longevity. So Mitchell was wondering, what are the mechanism for that association in terms of the association related to the anti-diabetic actions?
Well, the intervention question is a difficult question, actually. So because I tried to mention that interventions, they may work in different ways and through different mechanisms. There's a large cluster of interventions, calorie restriction-like interventions, like this various genetic models, methionine restriction, and so on, every other day feeding. They seem to kind of regulate metabolism. But then the other interventions still unclear exactly how they work, like CMIC deficiency, I don't fully understand, but it's kind of different way. In terms of metformin, I don't know. Metformin actually did not show an effect in the ITP trial. In mice, it showed no effect. So it might still work in humans. I don't know. It's probably a very mild effect. So it's like this. So mechanistically, it could be different. There are different ways. Basically, what we consistently observe is that there are many ways to kind of remodel the system so that it might live longer. It's just not just one way. Yeah.
Surprising in a way how many different strategies work for a complex system.
Right. And also, this is also clear from screens in simple organisms, like in C. elegans or yeast, like about 10% of genes, you manipulate 10% of genes and it leads to lifespan extension. So initially it was surprising, but to me, it's not surprising. It's just we modulate the system, so it becomes a different system. They accumulate different types of damage. And sometimes it just lives longer. That's all.
I mean, it also comes back to the evolutionary argument that we're not optimized for longevity, we're optimized for fitness. And
of course,
tweaking the system and may cost fitness but increase longevity.
Yes, when we try to extend lifespan, often it would be at the expense of something else, right? We might not be as strong, maybe we might not see as well or whatever, but we might live longer.
So one of our audience is actually quite interested about causal biomarkers. Do you mind to expand a bit more on that?
Yeah, this is a new work. So far, we only placed a paper in BioArchive, and the manuscript is under review currently. It's a genetic approach. We utilize genetic approach, and only can be done in humans so far, simply because there's a wealth of genetic information on enlarged kind of biobanks and data sets. This way we were able to kind of enrich for causal sites that represent damaging changes which kind of shorten lifespan versus adaptive changes which kind of allow to prolong lifespan, and use them, these different sets of CPG sites, to build epigenetic clocks. And then we apply them in different settings. And I showed you one example in the case of reprogramming, but there are other examples we observe when they show different effects compared to existing clocks. And sometimes only these causal clocks show an effect of interventions. Some of the nutritional approaches, for example, cannot be seen with any of the other clocks that we observe, only with causal clocks. But in other cases, some other clocks are better. So it's just not, I would say it's a very important step in developing biomarkers and understanding what exactly we measure, but it's just it's not the ultimate solution. It's a step forward.
So thanks, Belinda, and also thanks, Vadim, for joining us. It was a great conversation, and we'll have to do it again sometime.
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. It's really great to be with you, Brian. You have an amazing show, and I'm proud to be part of it.
Thank you. I want to remind the participants to use the chat function and panelists and all attendees option to leave comments and feedback on the show. And it better be that I look younger, not older with glasses, or I'm going to get angry. Our center is constantly looking for members who are driven and passionate about longevity research. And there's a QR code if you want to join the team that's at the end of the show. I'm excited to tell you that our new conference is just being announced, and it's on February 29th and March 1st. There's a QR code on the screen right now. The topic is Unlock Healthy Longevity, and the focus is on supplements. So if you're interested in that, please come to the conference. This is the first scientific conference focused solely on the role of supplements as a geroprotective intervention. And we're trying to bring together a wide array of experts, including scientists, clinicians, industry partners, and consumer representatives to explore the possibilities. So please join us for that. Our next episode is going to be Mike Snyder, who was mentioned in this talk today, and he'll be a very interesting person to discuss aging with. So I want to leave you with that. Thank you again for joining us, and come back next week.
Tony could remember the songs, but could he remember how to perform them in front of thousands of people? Lady Gaga knew it wasn't going to be easy.
And you know, Anderson, for the first couple of weeks that I saw Tony since COVID, he called me sweetheart. But I wasn't sure he knew who I was.
In rehearsals this July, she found new ways to connect and communicate with her old friend. When asking him questions, she'd keep it simple.
For example, if I were to say, Tony, would you like to sing Love for Sale? He'll say, yeah. And if I say, Tony, would you like to sing Love for Sale? Or it don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. He might not have as easy of a response.
Do you want to sing Anything Goes?
Yeah.
All right, great. Anything goes.
When that music comes on, it's something happens to him. He knows exactly what he's doing. And what's important for me, actually, just to make sure that I don't get in the way of that.
On opening night in early August, Radio City's 6,000 seats were sold out. It was Tony's 95th birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
And his fans were waiting. Lady Gaga opened the show. Backstage, Susan did her best to remind Tony what was happening.
We're going to watch Lady Gaga's set.
Right.
And then you're going to sing. Okay?
How many songs am I singing?
I'll tell you what you're going to sing.
When it was time, they walked toward the stage together. Then the lights went out and the curtain went up.
Once he saw the audience, and you know, and he raises his hands, I knew we were all right. Because he became himself. He just turned on. You know, it was like a light switch.
I'm feeling like sunshine, like springtime, like something's in the water, and I'm taking a deep dive. I'm feeling so weightless, like I'm gonna make it. And nothing in the universe can take this. I can see it clearly now. Nothing gonna bring me down.